reach you, we've taken steps to alert the legal representatives of Heathrow Hub to the fact that we're not going to be reaching them today. So they know that. Just taking a broader view of the programme, we are going to finish the hearing this week. That, I think, now suggests, given the slippage in the timetable, that we will sit tomorrow at 10, as I've said, and we will sit on Friday at 10. But lest anyone think that we're going to sit longer than the allotted 6 days, we're not. It's not a message in your direction particularly, it's for everybody to digest. Thank you.
Well, look, I need to finish up the last of the SEA issues, which is page 4 of my references notes. Before Mr. Humphreys got to it, I've dealt with the LES point, which is the secondary aspect of the plans and programmes.
Yes.
I think what the heading noise issues, just you'll know there are two arguments. One is the 54 versus 51 DB, Mr. Humphreys has already to some extent addressed. Whereas the other is a complaint, which in my submission is quite hard to identify as to precisely what the complaint is, about the use that we made of indicative flypaths, and in particular indicative flypaths that we used. And I'm going to try and trace that through. Whereas by way of just background, I'm going to ask you probably repeatedly to get your judgment.
Yep.
And also volume 6, which has the witness statements. You may have to dip into a couple of other bundles, but hopefully not too many. Well, in the judgment, 464 and 465, records, in my sense, entirely accurately, the case that's being put by Boroughs below on this aspect of SEA. And you'll see the court refers to quotes from paragraph C, environmental characteristics of areas likely significantly affected, and then says, subject to the same qualifications in Article 5, to which we've already referred, so that's the reason it's required. Thus, the Secretary of State was required, is the argument, to identify those areas which he judged would be likely to be significantly affected by, in the case of Preston 9.2, noise. Mr. Fleming said this was an important step because it would enable comparison to be made and to ensure the communities affected would like to be consulted. And then you've got 465, the two elements. And element one is the indicative aircraft flypaths which were used. That is the complaint that was made below. Not that we used indicative flypaths per se, as we'll come to in a moment, because that's accepted that that was justifiable. But Boroughs didn't like the indicative flight paths that we used. The fact that we used one set and this was said to be insufficient. And I'm going to come to why that's important in a moment. In the notion of 48, I've set out the key documents, so the key part of the judgment, the evidence from Mr. Latinga in his two witness statements, the relevant part of Caroline Lowe's witness statement, and also the relevant pages from Ms. Stevenson's witness statement. Can I ask you to go to Ms. Stevenson's witness statement? It's in point 49, I think. So we need to go to page 288 in bundle 6, witness statements bundle. And we'll just to get an overall sense of what the AOS was doing in terms of noise. We see at 3.103, page 288, last three lines. Talking about noise here, you can see there's a heading in the down page which is dealing with this.
Let's find it first, shall we?
Sorry. So bundle 288, paragraph 3.103.
Thank you, yes.
You'll see this is in the context of noise, and noise effects. Three lines from the bottom, these effects, these noise effects, were assessed under the SEA regulations as being predominantly significant negative. A as they were identified as being direct and cumulative, with a high probability of long-term effects occurring during formation, which are permanently reversible. And they're categorised as high magnitude with potential for national extent. So there's no question that noise was looked at, and the conclusion was, looking at it on an unmitigated basis, was that what the ARS was doing, that there would be significant adverse effects from noise. There was no hiding from that conclusion in the AOS. My Lords, leaving that open, if you look at the judgments, you'll see it's a similar effect, but on a slightly different point. Judgment 466 and 467. 466, which I think Mr. Fleming at least referred you to yesterday.
Yes.
A very clear conclusion in the AOS that far more people would be affected by an expansion of Heathrow. Simple reason being, as it says in 466, there's a much higher density of population. And then in 467, you'll see the AOS is getting the same point, even on the basis of the assessment found out in the AOS, using the effect as criticised by the effect of negative effects on pointing to that power community, were assessed as being a greater magnitude than the Heathrow schemes compared to the Gatwick schemes. And then, well, similarly, in 471, this will probably avoid us having to deal with the next reference I've got, which is the Catholic team parallel load witness statement 51. But 471, we'll see that the use of indicative paths for the three schemes, i.e. the way we did this in the test, was considered to be appropriate for taking our key strategic decisions. And it says this: the AOS noise assessment is based on one set of indicative flight paths. Why? This is consistent with the approach adopted by the Air Force and the purpose of this assessment is to draw out the key strategic considerations relevant to noise. In the light of this, the government considers the AOS to be satisfactory, given the airspace design is currently highly uncertain, etc. And that's exactly the same point that's made by Caroline Lowe in her witness statement in the reference I've given you at paragraph 51 of the note. And then still in the judgment, this is paragraph 52 of my note, in the judgment 469, well, there's a useful summary by the Division of Court of what the policy requirements are of noise that are set in the AMPS. Remembering there is no challenge to the substantive content of the policy tests, i.e. it's not said that the wrong policy tests have been set. And on 469 Roman 3, there are various summaries, various things that have to be done. So you'll see at Roman 1, the AMPS tells you what you have to include in the noise assessment as part of the EIA. 2 deals with mitigation, but 3 is the test for consent. Development consent should not be granted unless the Secretary of State is satisfied. Proposals will meet the following aims for the effective management and control of noise within the context of government policy and scale of development. Avoid significant adverse impacts on health, of course, and quality of life. We'll mitigate and minimise the adverse impacts and where possible contribute to improvements to health and quality of life. So that's the test that would have to be met by any applicant on the DCO, ultimately, in relation to noise. There's obviously a lot of detail, which I'm not going to go into, about what they have to do to assess that noise at the development control stage. And then, well, paragraph 53 of the note, just by giving you the records, I won't take them up. Part of the package of measures accompanying expansion was the setting up of an independent commission on civil aviation noise, so a new regulator to assist in relation to dealing with noise issues that would arise, not just from Heathrow, but generally in relation to civil aviation. And I'll give you some references when I go to that. If I then turn to the two complaints, indicative flight paths. Well, first of all, it's agreed that we were not required to use actual flight paths, but can we just explore why for a moment? 473 in the judgment. Not surprisingly, Mr. Fleming does not contend that actual flight paths should be used in the AOS. And I'll come back to 473 in a minute. But if you go over to 476, sort of down to 476, of course, so on the material before the court, there can be no legal objection to the use of indicative flight paths as a matter of principle. And one of the reasons for that is because it's simply not possible. There are no actual flight paths at this stage. I've then given you a couple of references later on, which I'll come to about the why of that. But the issues that were raised by the boroughs, we saw a moment ago, 473, back to 473. In his reply, Mr. Fleming submitted, in the absence of actual flight paths, a representative spatial area should have been used, an area within which it's likely that landings and takeoffs causing noise pollution to occur. One set of indicative flight paths, particularly when it's known that there will have to be flight path changes, does not cover areas likely to be significantly affected. And then, lest there be any doubt, the note also makes the case clear. The claimant's case is there should be the use of the geographical area over which flight paths may be located. So that was the case. And what was the key problem with that case that's being advanced below, and still to some extent being advanced, so I understand it before your lordships, 475. In our judgment, claiming such an approach based on areas over which flight paths may be located is substantially different from the one based on areas within which it's likely that landing. Former approach does not accord with paragraph C, annex 1, and therefore Mr. Fleming's submission is misconceived. I'm going to just explore just in a moment why that is so, but my lords, just pausing for a moment, we're looking at likely significant effects. Whether there is a likely significant effect depends on the combination of two things. One is the impact, the effect, if it occurs, how significant would that be? But the second is, how likely is it to occur? And one of the classic example of that, I don't ask you to go to it, but the Anne Tash case that you've got in Authorities Bundle 3, tab 54, was an EIA case about transboundary effects. And the question was, in relation to a nuclear project, there was the remotest possible risk of a particular type of accident that would have had a transboundary effect. But the chances of it happening were absolutely remote. And obviously, if it did happen, it would have a very large effect. And the Court of Appeal held in Antash, that was not a likely significant effect, because
it's a hazard matrices, really, isn't it?
Correct. Yes,
likely and effects.
That's exactly a classic analysis. That's exactly what I'm right. That's exactly right. And that's certainly very strongly supported by the Court of Appeal decision in Antash, which you have. The argument then becomes really that we should have put forward some very large spatial area, a bit like the plans that you've had produced by Mr. Stanbury attached to his witness statement, which, as we know, actually show for airspace change purposes flight paths up to 7,000 feet. And of course, what we also know from the judgment at 481 and from Mr. Humphrey's submissions, that above 4,000 feet there will be no discernible noise issue, certainly no significant noise issue. That's CAA advice. And with that, can I ask you just to turn briefly to Caroline Lowe's witness statement? This is 58 and 59 from my note. So it's page 225. Based on the minimised total effective equal airspace design. And just note that, and I'll come to why that's used at the moment, to assess strategic level the noise from Heathrow at WR, the NR scheme. As said above, the airport commission selected minimised total effective people airspace design as the basis for the assessment in its final report into enable a comparison to take place on a like-for-like basis of the two Heathrow schemes. And then one was page 514, just in passing. Precise flight path designs can only be funded at a late stage in the process after detailed airspace design work is taking place. And I'll have one extra footnote on that in a moment. And 515, given the many moving parts in airspace reports, it's not possible at this stage to provide anything more than an indication of where flight paths could be. But such indicative flight paths are helpful to provide a basis for comparing impacts across schemes to inform decision making. If department therefore considers the use of one set of flight paths as the basis was appropriate at this stage to draw out those key strategic considerations. And then can I just give you, one other document that's not referred to in the note, but just to show you what's going on in terms of these moving parts. It's volume 2, tab 7, page 1123. So volume 2, I'll keep out the witness statements for now. So, volume 2, tab 7, page 1123. This is actually within our summary grounds on the Borough's case. It's a point that's made elsewhere. I found it here. You'll see at the top of the page 2, so it's paragraph 200. Sub 2. Precise flight paths are determined through separate statutory process of airspace change, super leg. It's a complex process involving the assessment of the interaction between new flight paths and existing air traffic arrangements. Again, it's not a process that can be carried out in full without precisely because of the runways. Final airspace change approval necessarily follows the grant of the DCM. This is necessary to know the precise location of the runway for the airspace change process and the consultation that's required to comply with it. By way of example, the displaced threshold where aircraft heads for landing is crucial, as is the departure point. And the CAA considers that repositioning either by 100 metres, which could reasonably happen at DCO stage, is sufficient to warrant a full airspace change being followed. It's a further reason why interpretive flight paths are used at the FPS stage. So even a small change to the location of the position of the runway can have a huge impact in terms of the airspace position.
The displaced threshold is the approach before final approach.
Well, that's correct, that's what it's. Yes. So the changes can be very significant. And then we'll also, we can put away that volume, just returning to the note. There is a complaint within the skeleton, not really pursued orally, that the scenario that we selected, indicative flight path focused on minimised total, was a best case, so you should have used the worst case. We don't know the precise flight path. But the judgment of 480 records, it was neither a best case nor a worst case. It was in the middle, and I've given you the references to Mike Fettinger's evidence in support of that. But the more important question is, why did we choose minimised total? This is point 62. And that's answered by the judgment of 482. I've also given you the references to the evidence that underlie it. But 482 is the judgment. Mr. Lutzinger stated that the minimised total strategy for identifying indicative flight paths was considered to be the most representative of the strategies examined and a likely general strategy for adoption in the future. Now, I'm pausing there. The reason for that, when you look at his evidence, is that that's the scenario that's consistent with government policies on noise to seek to minimise the total affected. So his view was that that's the most likely solution. I mean, there are lots of different solutions, but he thought that the most likely, in his judgment, solution. Hence the use of minimised total. And of course, that was also the same approach used by the Airports Commission for the same reason. And then, well, it's just on that last thing on worst and best case. I don't ask you to go to this, but 63. Caroline Lowe explains in her first little statement that the AOS does contain a number of sensitivity tests, which were looking at what we say was effectively a worst case, or certainly a likely worst case on sensitivity tests. And then, Mollis, can I come to this issue about areas? Mollis, the complaint appeared to be in the skeleton of paragraph 79, and also orally, that we failed to identify any geographic area. Now, Mollis, if that's the complaint, it's simply wrong, because the only complaint that can be made, and as I understood it, was the complaint that was being made, but there's no geographic area. So the complaint is not that there are no geographic areas. Mollis, the reason for that, and if, what I've done is I've given you references of B, C, and D. I'll come to a couple more of these in a moment, but also E. There were contour plans showing this scenario overlaid on geographical areas. So you could look at the contour to match our minimised total scenario on our indicative flight path and see whether you were affected by that. So there was a geographic representation through the contour. There was an area identified. It's the area that lies under the contours. Now, it doesn't end there. I'm going to come back to that in a moment. So the real complaint that's made by the boroughs is that they don't consider that approach is the equivalent of likely significant effects. They think we should have shown some other area, some wider area, in order to identify likely significant effects. But models, there was more than simply, we had contours for that key scenario available through the AOS, and I've given you reference to that, but it's more than that. Can we look at Mr. Latinga's first witness, this is F, 64F. If you look in bundle 6, page 370, just an example of the kind of material that was made available to people.
Sorry, bundle?
It's bundle 6, my lord, possibly the special bundle.
At page
370.
Thank you.
On the draft NPS included public information events, 20 locations around the boroughs, as well as 12 regional events around the country I attended, etc. Just four or five lines down, all the information events included an interactive digital map table on which noise contours were presented overlaid on a geographic map of Heathrow and surrounding areas. The maps included contours for the recent past baseline, future due minimum no expansion, and future due something with expansion situation. Noise contours included 54 dB, 57, 60, 55, and the areas enclosed by contour indicating the zones in which aircraft noise levels were expected to be higher than these values. And then 4.2.34, in addition to the events, the same digital map was published on the internet, allowed online access to the same noise contour data as displayed on the map table, and it allowed people to enter a postcode and see whether they were affected. Well, again, it doesn't end even there, because can I ask you, read that open, can I ask you to go to bundle 8?
Are we putting that away?
No, my lord, I need to leave 6 out.
Right.
Bundle 8, page 1683. In paragraph 35, towards the bottom, he refers to the indicative map table, which we just read about being popular. But there were complaints that showed only indicative and not detailed flight paths. Please see below. And if you go below to 1689, you'll see 46. The map table local events showed a range of indicative noise controls of different operations. Based on the Airports Commission analysis of flight paths, lacked detailed information on future of the subject of the complaints, contended the consultation could not be fairly undertaken if the consultee did not know what the detailed flight path would be, etc. Then there's a quotation from what the NPS says about that. And then 48, even if it were part of my role to question the merits of the policy, I'd have described the new runway detailed flights as just a chicken and egg question. In order to determine a detailed flight path, the CAA will need to know whether there is to be airport capacity, whether that capacity would be a Heathrow gateway, for Heathrow, whether by new or extended runway. Once planning position is clarified, then flight paths can be determined in accordance with the policy framework. And then towards the end of that paragraph, I consider it's possible to hold a fair consultation on the draft NPS is open to consultees to respond if it's their view that lack of detailed flight paths undermines the cogency of the government's approach to the issue of noise complaints. Of course, that was an issue raised in consultation responses by a number of people. So that's part of the information that was considered as part of the assessment. And well, as it goes further than that, if I can just ask you also, while we're here, to look at 1687.3. 1687.3. And there's a heading 21, publicity. talking about various publicity events. But if you go to 1687.5, this is a passage I think Simon showed you elsewhere. And you see about 5 lines down in paragraph 24, the department decided to adopt a similar approach to the 2017 consultation, decided to send a leaflet to residents within 54D void noise quantity in order to provide the most accessible consultation possible. Following discussion with local authorities, the department extended the scope of the leaflet to include all households within each local authority, even if they were not within the noise contour. So if your local authority area was penetrated by the contour, the decision was made to leaflet the whole of the local authority area, not just those people who fell within the contour within that area.
That was paragraph
24. 24, sorry. 5 lines down, the department decided to adopt. 5th line down, 24.
Oh, yes.
Started sent leaflets for new residents within those areas. And my lord, if we can put away bundle 8, and just go back to bundle 6, where we were a moment ago. If you turn, my lord, to page 155. Section of Ms. Lane's witness statement, which starts back on page 133, where she goes through all the detail of the consultation that was undertaken. The reason this is here is because, as your lordship may appreciate, there were some other consultation challenges at the level. But I'll just simply give a flavour of consultation, the scale of it. If you look at page 155, paragraph 231, you'll see from the beginning that there's a list of a number of authorities who were consulted on how to undertake the consultation. Because there's a statutory requirement in Section 8 of the Planning Act that you have to consult local authorities about how to consult. So you have to consult local authorities on how you're going to consult before you undertake the consultation. So it's a consultation requirement focused at consultation. But there it is, and that's what we did. So 231, you'll see the list of authorities that were initially consulted, 16 of them. But things developed, so I'm not going to go through all this, I haven't got time, but paragraph 237 on page 158. Later in the process, a large number of other authorities going well beyond London, and into London as the centre, were added to the consultation, talked to. And also there were other forms of consultation as well. If you look at page 156, I should just pick this up, 232, the decision was made to go with the two bullet points there, press adverts in the Evening Standard, Metro, City AM, posters, digital content, so Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, website, and a short article on each local authority website, news section, and overpage press releases as well. Now, well, that's just a taste of it. There are hundreds of paragraphs about consultation. And that's why, you'll see if you go back to Sir Jeremy Sullivan's report, he was, apart from one or two criticisms of very specific things that happened, concluded that it was a very comprehensive and effective consultation in terms of letting people know that this was something that they could engage with.
Richard, that may be right, but I think Mr. Fleming's fundamental complaint is... I'm not saying he's right, but I think if I've understood his complaint is that if consulted, you might be lulled into a full sense of security because you might do the interactive digital table exercise and find that you're in an area which doesn't ping.
You might, that is true. But the obligation...
And yet he says you might in fact be in an area likely to be significantly affected.
Well, we know we haven't got actual fire. So we had to make a decision about how to do it. What we did was, we took a view that using the minimised total and those indicative flight paths gave you the likely significantly affected areas of people. Now, that's a judgement based on how likely it is that those will be the flight paths, combined with what the effects would be if those were the flight paths. And what was it, in a situation where we don't have exact flight paths, we say that was the proper, and indeed the only sensible approach to go down. The only alternative, is literally what Mr. Fleming is urging, which is you just draw a vast circle around the airport and say to everyone, that's the area that's going to be likely to affect, which of course it wouldn't be, because realistically, a lot of those areas are not going to be affected at all.
Yes, that's
so it was a judgment that we made, and one was just to support that a little bit further. There was one question, if you go to paragraph 66 of the notice, there was a complaint raised by Mr. Fleming yesterday. I'm not sure I can recall it being pursued before, but it don't matter because we've got the answer to it. He refers to Annex 1H, which says that your assessment or report should set out what the difficulties are with undertaking the assessment, the know-how and the technical issues. And what I've given you there are a series of references. I'll take up maybe just one of them, D. One example, CB7812, that's the noise, so four bundles, seven, so bundle seven, page 812. There are a number of examples of this. So the short point is that in multiple places the report records the biggest limitation in terms of the assessments is the fact that there are no actual fire parts at this stage. So if you look at 812, you can see there's assumptions and limitations. So those significant assumptions are probably more skinny than include. All of these assumptions will have significant influence on the predictions of noise exposure. And then limitations are discussed in section 4.11 below. And while we've got that open, we can have just a look at that, 4.11.2. So, at page 816, it should be noted that the flight paths used in the modelling are indicative. Would not necessarily be the same as in practice. The degree of uncertainty in flight path center lines is, however, inherent in the modelling, which incorporates dispersion factors considered representative of each scheme. The routes used are physically compatible with anticipated future airspace navigation technology. So, well, in a number of places, we did, as we were required to by the directive, to set out that one of the big limitations on the assessment was we are in an indicative stage. And then was finally on this 67, I don't ask you to go back to it, but Mr. Fleming showed you, I think, one paragraph in the ministerial submission. And I asked you, in due course, to read the document as a whole. And I asked you also to read it alongside judgment 486. There is nothing untoward about that ministerial submission. There was a disagreement between the department and HAL about how far HAL's consultation needed to go. They disagreed on how to interpret what the requirements were, but there's nothing sinister about it, as Mr. Fleming was trying to suggest. And then I can deal very briefly with the last point, because Mr. Humphreys dealt with this quite extensively, on the 54 versus 51 DB issue. And my lords, that first paragraph, 68, should actually be 489 of the judgment. I don't ask you to go to it, but there's a quotation there from the government's response to the consultations. And that quotation contains the same sort of material that Mr. Humphreys was taking you to about why 54 was used. I don't think I need to say anything about lower and sole. There's then some evidence I've given you from Mr. Latinga. Mr. Latinga's evidence, I won't ask you to go to it, is 70.
Well, pausing just for a second, do you adopt Mr. Humphreys' submission?
I do, yes.
Well, that's just my next.
Because, my lord, if you have got judgment 489, page 585, you'll see there's a quotation from the government's response. And paragraph 7.55 of that quotation is making exactly the same points that Mr. Humphreys is making to use it. For example, seven lines down, for practical reasons, it becomes more difficult to estimate noise exposure accurately, and therefore population unexpected below the 54 noise level. So it's exactly the same as the Humphreys is showing you that elsewhere, but that's consistently been the government's position. And you'll also, if you look back at my notes, I don't take you to it now, but I've given you one reference at 70 to Mr. Singer's evidence where he confirms that that is a technically correct conclusion, that is the difficulty. And Mr. Humphreys, I think, showed you that the very same comments are made in the AOS itself. He took you to those. I'm not going to go to them. But one other point, well, 71, I'd add this, but we don't have to go to it, but Caroline Lowe's evidence is that The government specifically sought the CAA's advice on this. The expert regulator in relation to airspace change, but also on noise issues, asked them, should we be using the 51 dB that they use for airspace change? And their view was no, for the same reasons, technical issues.
And where do we find that?
Well, if you look at the Caroline Lowe's, it's paragraph 71 of my notes, it's Caroline Lowe's witness statement, paragraph 521.
Yes, thank you.
That's the reference where she explains that that's what they did. And then, well, again, I don't ask you to go to 72. We did, in fact, look on a sort of sensitivity analysis at some other principles, so not just 54 dB. And Ms. Lowe explains that in her paragraph 5.2. And then, well, finally, 338. Probably should change is 338, 339, 506. Again, I suspect this probably does replicate to some degree Mr. Humphrey's submissions, but Mr. Latinga, page 338 in volume 6, 3.39. He's reviewed over the pages various government policy statements and says these statements confirm in aviation noise policy terms a suitable threshold that potentially, thereby potentially significant effect is considered to be the 54 dB LAQ 60 hour, although this is not explicitly adopted in policy as such. In the AOS, the assessment approach taken is that any predicted increase in exposure to the noise impact category of 54 dB above due to an expansion option constitutes a significant negative effect. And then what was the point is simply that's what one is looking for, not some lower matter such as Lowell, i.e. where adverse effects can be detected, one's looking for significant effects, and that's what we do. So, well, that completes the note. Well, just two other things, by the way. The witness statement that came in this morning, my lord.
Can we now clear the decks of the evidence?
I adopt Mr. Humphrey's submissions on the value of the composite plan, which is not very much value because you attain to it. But can I just raise this with you? In paragraphs 9 and 10 of that statement, for reasons I'm not entirely clear about at the moment, it starts talking about.
Pause. I'm sorry. Let us just catch up to you.
So Stanbury 3.
Stanbury 3, well, it was paragraph 1 and 10 that came in this morning.
Yes.
It starts talking about NX metrics. So NX metrics.
Paragraph 8.
Well, yes. So I'm not quite sure why this has been introduced in relation to this, but can I just give you a reference? This was an issue raised at one point in the proceedings. And can I just give you the reference to where it's dealt with in Mr. Singh's evidence in case it's relevant? Although, well, I struggle to see what real relevance this has to your launches. Well, it's volume 6 again, tab 1, page 347 following, and it's paragraphs 3.3.64 through to 3.3.70. Well, yeah. That's all I said on that statement, and then I'll very finally, relief. I've dealt with that in my skeleton.
Alright, so you adopt what you said in your skeleton.
That's what I say on my skeleton. I also support the
submissions
that he
makes. On this aspect of the question of relief, your submissions and his align.
They do. Well, unless I can assist you further, those are my.
Just get ourselves ready to hear Mr. Bennett's submissions. Yes, Mr. Bennett.
my lords, in the hope of making the most of my short time, I've produced a note to save your pens. If I can hand that up.
Right, thank you very much.
I'm also going to hand up a hard copy this evening of the Upjohn case, which I saw.
Oh, yes. Yes. You told us you were going to mention that.
Preliminary matters, my lords. Firstly,
well, you're out of the blocks very fast, Mr. Banner. I'm going to call you back. Just pause, please. Thank you very much. Now you may start.
Thank you. Firstly, I adopt this breach as suspicions in their entirety. Secondly, I do of course take my skeleton as read. I will be making some references to it, so it may help to have it handy. And thirdly, the focus of my oral submissions will be on the standard review. Except where I indicate otherwise, everything I say will apply both to habitats and to SEO.
Yes.
And with that, I'll turn to the note. And the first foray into the skeleton. The starting point of my submission is position set out in paragraph 16 of my skeleton.
Yes.
Namely, that the directive, neither directive, prescribes the right of appeal to any particular procedure for challenging decisions made pursuant to those directives, and therefore the principle of national procedural autonomy applies. That's a general principle of EU law applicable in the absence of harmonising measures. That takes us into Craneness, paragraph 2 of my note. And if I can ask the court to indulge me in taking you back to paragraph 54, that's authorities 1, tab 22. Subject to the principle of equivalence, non-discrimination, that's not in play here, and the principle of effectiveness. And I do draw the court's attention to the precise formulation that the court uses here, as it has done in many other cases, including Upjohn, that the litmus test for the effectiveness principle, about five or six lines down, is whether it is impossible in practice or excessively difficult to exercise the rights conferred by relevant EU law provision. Please keep Craneness open for a moment. Turning then to paragraph 3 of my note. My learned friend's skeleton, neither on the issue of habitats nor on the issue of SEA, grappled at least directly with that formulation. And yet it was critical to this issue. And I ask the court to bear this in mind. As I understand their case on standard review, they disavow any suggestion of full merits review. They argue for various candidate midpoints, whether it's height and entry or proportionality or something else. Now, in light of that, for their analysis to be coherent and in accordance with principle, they would need to articulate why the midpoint they contend for is not only necessary, but also sufficient. And they don't make any attempt to do so, and I suggest that reveals the lack of coherence in their analysis. I then turn paragraph 4 of the note to some of the cases that either do or have been said to deal with effectiveness in the context of standard review. Craneness paragraph 55 is the first one of those. As Mr. Ricci indicated yesterday, in fact in Craneness there's no dispute that the relevant power of the court, the domestic court, was in existence, and the court simply held that the domestic court should exercise that power in accordance with the principle of national autonomy. So there's no finding that a particular standard of review was not in accordance with in that case. Point B, Holohan, I simply mentioned to say it's not relevant. It's not on point. My learned friend, Mr. Fleming, clutches to the term adequately, but the multitude of questions referred to the court in that case didn't include the standard review. For what it's worth, I acted from the UK at the written stage of that case, not at the oral hearing, and the written observation of all the parties didn't deal with an issue of standard review. I can't speak for what happened in the oral hearing. That then takes me to Upjohn. And
we have that in front of us.
Yes.
Have we finished with Cranehurst for the
week? We have, yes, my lord. Sorry, I should have said.
Put that away.
And by way of background, if you have up done before you, it's the AG opinion first, page 227. And the context of this case related to medicinal product marketing licences, which were a prerequisite pursuant to the directive for such products to be on the EU market. And you get that for paragraphs 5 and 6. Paragraph 10 and 11 of the AG opinion describe how the directive prescribes the circumstances in which such a license can be revoked. The consequence, obviously, that you can't market the product. And you see that also in paragraph 12. You can't revoke other than on the grounds set out in the directive. Paragraph 25 describes the process then in place in the United Kingdom, or certainly England, relating to such revocation. There's an administrative phase, effectively you're able to make representations in response to a minor to revoke. And then paragraph 26, in the event that revocation followed, judicial review on conventional public law principles. For what it's worth, it was a statutory judicial review. I've given you reference to that, and that turns on that. And you see the way the court, the Advocate General describes the judicial review jurisdiction, paragraphs 26 and 27. 27 is precisely this limitation on the powers of review which is issued in this reference. Paragraph 32, Upjohn had their licence revoked. Paragraph 33, they brought a judicial review. And then the issue, paragraph 34, they take the view that the judicial procedure, I don't think, in response to my Lord or Justice Singh's question yesterday, the CJU describes standard review as falling within procedure, even though we might not do so here. It's within the remit of procedural autonomy. The judicial procedure ought to, in accordance with community law, enable the courts to verify the reliability of the scientific evidence, to assess afresh the issues of fact and law, rule on whether the decision is correct and complies with the principle of proportionality. That led to question one. Should the court, then picking up five lines at the bottom, decide whether the decision was correct, as opposed to a decision that the authority could reasonably have reached on the material before it, Wednesday? So that was the first question. The AG then deals with the first question on the next page, 233. And you see in paragraph 42, the argument was put by Upjohn by reference to the principle of effectiveness. Put in general terms rather than something peculiar to that directive. You then see one formulation of the principle of effectiveness of paragraph 43, and then critically paragraph 50. In my opinion, the limited judicial review of decisions taken by the National Authority in regard to marketing licences does not in any way call in question the effectiveness of the directive. The court has always taken the view that when an authority is required in the exercise of its functions to undertake complex assessments, a limited judicial review of the action which that authority alone is entitled to perform must be exercised, since otherwise that authority's freedom of action would be definitively paralysed. The reference to the court's earlier case law was in the context of judicial review of community acts in front of the CJU rather than in this context, but effectively the AG reads that across.
And the cases cited in support of that proposition are at footnote 19.
Yes, that's right. And they are yes, if it would help to have them, I can have those.
Well, no. What was the subject matter in United Kingdom and the Council?
It was a challenge. It was a challenge to a community. It was an EU judicial review case, so a challenge to a Council measure.
Yeah.
So effectively, what the AEG says, and you'll see the court follows this through, is saying that we can't expect national courts to do better than we do, or be more exacting than we are.
This is followed through in the judgment.
It is. So I think I'll take the rest of the AEG as read. I've given you the references there. Can I take you straight to the judgment, given the limitations of time? I have page 251, paragraph 32. Restates the usual autonomy subject to occurrence and effectiveness. Notably, almost identical to Crane S paragraph 54. And so therefore what follows at paragraphs 33, 34, and 35 is instructive as to the application of that principle in the UK judicial review context. And given the time, I won't read it out, but in essence, the court adopts in its own language the same reasoning as the AG. You note the term complex assessments features, as it did in the AG's opinion, in paragraph 33 and 34. And therefore, both paragraphs 35 and 37, the question is answered, no, you don't need more than one. Now, plainly it's a different directive and a different regulatory context, but I would suggest that the reference to complex assessments is not a million miles away from the SEA Habitats context, an indication of the court's likely application of the Crane's principles to judicial review in this context. If I may, I'll return to my note, page 2, paragraph 5. And then there's a considerable body of domestic case law applying conventional Wensbury in a range of EU environmental law contexts. I will skip over Habitats and the IED because you've heard about those already from Mr. Marucci. I'd like to just mention EIA, paragraph C1. Bowen West, I don't need to turn it up, but can I highlight two things? One, that was a challenge to the quality of an environmental statement. And in that context, the same term reasonably required, as is found in Article 5.2 of the SEA Directive, is found in the EIA context too. See paragraph 7 of the judgment, which refers to the implementing regulations, and Article 5.1b of the EIA Directive. See Roman numeral 2. This is the preface for Evans, which is the last case I'm going to take you to. Can I ask you to turn up the EIA Directive, Bundle 1, Tab 9. And please go to Article 11. Transposes elements, not all, but elements of Article 9 of the Orders Convention, which is in turn entitled Access to Justice, into the context of EIA. The IED Directive has similar provisions. Can I draw attention in particular to the Article 11.1, after the members of the public have sufficient interest must have access to review procedure to challenge substantive or procedural legality of decisions, acts or omissions, and then below 4, such procedures should be fair, equitable, timely, and not be able to be expensive. The rationale for that is set out in the recitals, the second page, the first double-sided leaf, second page of the directive, recital 18 simply refers to the Orders Convention, and 21, 21, you see the driver for our claim is access to justice. Unsurprisingly, because that's the Hillingdon Convention.
Title 18.
18 and 21. 18 and 21 is 21 refers specifically to Article 9.
Yeah.
Now, why is that significant? Well, in Evans, it was contended that those provisions meant that the previous case law applying Wensby to the EAA context no longer held good and something more exacting was required. And the court rejected that argument. Lord Justice, I should fairly point out, though it reads like a full judgment, it is a permission to appeal decision. You see that at the very beginning. So, strictly speaking, it's not binding on your lordship. I should point that out.
Is it even properly citable?
Well, it's reported. I don't know whether.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
It has been cited in many cases.
It has, yes.
Mr. Meach and I trotted out.
Yeah, no, it has been
fair
cited
regularity
many times.
I don't know whether there's an order authorising it to be able to be cited. I'd be surprised if there wasn't. It was reported, but I can't insist on taking that.
It was contested. So it was a contested hearing. Fully contested, actually, by the parties, I think. Except the first interested party.
Well, my prefer to hold up here. So it's 1:15, and I just want to draw firstly to your attention how the argument was put by Mr. Wolfe, as it happens. So page 1:30, paragraph 4, first of all, I just want to draw to the caution principle was relied upon in this case, just as it was relied upon by Mr. Fleming. Or Mr. Jaffe or both yesterday. Paragraph 5, you see about two-thirds of the way down, all the early case law predated the what was then Article 10A, the first version of Article 11 in the earlier EIA directive. And there is also reference to, as you'll see at paragraph 33, page 1035, in that context, the Orders Convention Compliance Committee's findings in the Port of Tyne case, which Mr. Fleming handed up yesterday, referred to footnote 2 of his note. And then I'm going to have to necessarily do a quick trot through Lord Justice Meach's reason and leave you to read it in your own time. But in essence, paragraph 34, Lord Justice Meach and held the earlier cases actually didn't all predate the incorporation of Article 9 into the EIA law. Paragraph 35, there was a infraction case where the CJE applied the manifest error of assessment, which essentially is the same as the judicial jurisdiction referred to in the Upjohn case. Paragraph 36, Valency case didn't make any difference either. Paragraphs 37 to 38 debunk the suggestion that the Articles Compliance Committee made any difference. Contrary to what footnote 2 of my learned friend's notes suggests, they didn't make any conclusions as to non-compliance. They expressly disavowed making final conclusions. They simply expressed provisional concern. In any event, Lord Justice Beaton wasn't very impressed by their reasoning. And also, paragraph 38, their findings don't have legal consequence. They report to the meeting of the parties, and the meeting of the parties decides what to do. So, what I say in my skeleton, looking to go to page 7, footnote 10, is it follows from evidence that the appellant's case involves the surprising proposition that the SEA directive and the Habitats directive have achieved more in relation to access to justice through silence than the EIA directive has done through express provision.
That goes back to your skeleton argument?
Yes, page 7, footnote 10. And for the avoidance of doubt, paragraph D on page 3 of my note, Article 12 of the SEA directive is no such express provision. It's not relevant in this context. Can I just very briefly take you to it? Tab 7 of Authorities 1. Fleming, as I understood the argument, sought to contend that the court as an emanation of the state was bound by these obligations, and that gave it a sort of judicial flavour of the nature of Article 11 of the EI Directive. Not so my submission. The content of Article 12 relates to reporting, review and exchange of information between member states. Those are quintessentially executive functions. This is nothing like Article 11 of the EI Directive, let alone something better, which would have to be under members. And we'll contest it, because if reference to member states is to include the courts, then my lords under Article 12.2 will be obliged to communicate to the Commission your judgment.
Why couldn't we be bound by the first half of that?
Because in my submission, my lord, the first half of that has to be read in the context of Article 12 as a whole, when it's clearly looking at monitoring systemically compliance with the directive, as opposed to scrutinising an individual environmental statement. I've already dealt with point E on page 3 of my note, turn to point 6. So that's dealt with the IAE, dealt with the IED, dealt with Article 6.3 of the Habitats Directive. And paragraph 6 says there's no basis for a different approach in the context either of 6.4 of the Habitats Directive or the SEA Directive. Firstly, the various principles and general provisions relied upon by the reference, the cautionary principle, Article 37 related to environmental protection. He didn't mention, but he might have done, Article 47, which is the right to an effective remedy. They're all general principles. They apply just as much in the EIA, IE, etc. context as in this context. So they're not distinguishing factors justifying a different position in the context of this protection. Secondly, page 4, paragraph B, both SEA and Article 6.4, I think I should find required to involve rather than required, involve complex assessments. They may not always be scientific assessments in the context of Article 6.4, but they're still complex policy assessments. So the Upjohn rationale in my submission applies. And in relation to then whether there's any basis for distinguishing between SEA and EIA, I rely on the court below, Mr. Ricci. A couple of further points. Firstly, in the HS2 case, Lord Carnworth quoted a rather helpful commission document describing the genesis and purpose of the SEA directive, and describe the SEA directive and the IA directive as to a large extent complementary, two sides of the same coin. And I do say at C2 as well that the succession of cases where SEA claims have succeeded on conventional public law grounds illustrates that the application of those conventional principles hasn't made enforcement of the directive impossible or excessively difficult in domestic courts. Then finally, 7, in relation to habitats, the only point I want to make beyond adopting the reason of the court below, Mr. Ricci, is just to recall the formulation of the effectiveness principle. Render it impossible in practice or excessively difficult, rights conferred by EU law. Now, the Habitats Directive, certainly Article 6.4, doesn't, at least in any ordinary sense, conventional sense, confer rights. Now, I don't say that precludes the application of the effectiveness principle. I don't need to go that far. But what I do say is contrast it with the EIA directive, SEA directive, and IED, industrial directive, where public participation rights are essential. You find the word rights in it. They're built in. So the whole point is involving the public in the process of environmental decision making. And I suggest, therefore, that it would be odd if the effectiveness principle is more demanding in relation to the standard of review where such rights are not engaged and where they are. So therefore, if you're with me on SEA, I suggest that tells in favour of also being with me on the habitats. I think I strayed a few minutes over my time. I suppose in percentage times, I'm the biggest sinner in that regard, but I hope you'll forgive me. Thank you very much.
We're not going to hold you to that.
That's like a sister call. Those are my suggestions.
Thank you very much. Can we just put Upjohn in the... authorities panel.
Tab 74.
Thank you. Volume 4, tab 74. Is it you first or Mr. Fleming?
Radiological provision, me
yes.
First.
Yes.
Can I just hand up an incomplete note of references? Because obviously there have been more points made this morning.
Thank you. Yeah, well, no, we're always grateful for a note with references.
I propose to deal with 3 points in reply. The hard facts, first of all, secondly, a bit of law, and then a mulligan.
Right.
On path, dealing with that first, there is still, in our submission, an inconsistency at the heart of the Secretary of State's position and the assessment of alternatives under the SEA directive and the Habitat Act. The Secretary of State consulted on the wording on which reliance is placed, the not enhanced and with therefore threatened wording, and also consulted on the Secretary of State's view as to hub status, so that's paragraph 3.71, which Mr. Humphreys referred the court to this morning, the only wording. In that consultation, that's the October 2017 consultation, the Secretary of State also maintained at the same time, and consulted on the basis that Gatwick was a reasonable alternative. And both those sets of wordings, the not enhanced and would therefore threaten wording relied on by Mr. Marici, and 3.71, the only wording relied on by Mr. Humphreys, were also present in the final decision. But still, the same stance was taken under the FCA directive, that Gatwick remains a reasonable alternative. This is not a case, there can be such cases, but this is not a case in which, as a result of iterative analysis, going through several stages of thinking, that the inconsistency can be explained. The inconsistency was there during the consultation process and it has remained. So the question is there a good explanation for it? Consistent with the purpose of the two directives. Now, the starting point is that Mr. Marici, for the Secretary of State, disavows any submission that the Secretary of State, in fact, over-assessed for the purposes of the SEA directive. The Secretary of State has never said that previously and does not say that now. So we have to proceed on the basis that the Secretary of State's conclusion was that the option of Gatwick was in fact a reasonable alternative for the purpose of the SEA directive. And your Lordship's explored that issue with Mr. Marici in a little detail. And he maintained that position. And he was quite sensible, in my submission, not to go there, because in public law terms, of course, that has flashing neon lights marked elephant trap. If you were to take that argument, it would give rise to serious questions about whether an ex post facto justification is being put forward. So it's entirely understandable that Mr. Marici maintained the position which clearly emerges from the documents, that the Secretary of State, in fact, considered that Gatwick was a reasonable alternative for the purpose of the SEA. I would add, and this is in the references note at paragraph 1.1, there can't have been an over-assessment because the relevant passages of the appraisal of sustainability all expressly cite and seek to apply the statutory test. Indeed, they quote the statutory test for a reasonable alternative word to word. I won't take you back to those materials. So, Mr. Marici instead focuses his argument on 2 points.
First of all, the notion that the legal test for the identification of a reasonable alternative under SEA is satisfied more easily than under the Habitat Directive because of the different purpose and structure of operation of the SEA Directive as compared to Habitats. And secondly, he also says, and these points of course run together, that looking at the reasoning in the National Policy Statement, there was in fact a decision that Gatwick could not meet the objectives of the National Policy Statement and was not therefore an alternative solution. And I'll take both those points and deal with them if I may. As to the first point, there isn't any authority which has been cited supporting the proposition that under the SEA Directive, a decision maker, here the Secretary of State for Transport, should take a generous approach to identifying alternatives in order to somehow facilitate the consultation process. Indeed, if anything, the authorities suggest precisely the opposite. The actual test requires a proper consideration as to whether an alternative is in fact reasonable and meets the objectives. And there may well be no alternative at all. And you've heard my submission already that it should be harder to exclude an alternative under the Habitats Directive because of the comparison with Article 16 of the Habitats Directive and the absence of the word reasonable and the absence of the reference to objectives. But in practical terms, it's an absurd exercise for an SEA consultation to be over-inclusive in terms of alternatives, because the only purpose of that exercise is to identify reasonable alternatives. If you go too wide, you end up with an inappropriate and mistargeted consultation exercise, and all sorts of submissions will end up being made on potential projects that the decision-maker's actual view are ones which could never be pursued. If the alternatives are not viable or reasonable, and they don't meet the objectives which are being put forward, then it's a waste of everyone's time to consult. It doesn't in truth contribute to the public participation purpose of the SEA Directive. And in truth, it actually substantially detracts from that public participation purpose. Now, exactly the same logic in my submission applies to the Habitats Directive. And indeed, this is an area in which the Divisional Court accepted the submissions made on behalf of the appellants. If I could ask the Court to briefly turn up paragraph 322 of the Divisional Court's decision. Sentence of 322, talking about the concept of alternatives, this is a crucial issue because, as we've indicated, if and as soon as a scheme is not an alternative under Article 6.4, then it's not necessary to consider it any further under the Habitats Directive. And if so, it's properly assessed as not an alternative before an HRA has been performed, and then jumping to the end of that paragraph, it simply drops out of account. If and as soon as. So throughout the process of assessment of plans and projects, here the Secretary of State may decide that something is no longer an alternative. And at that point, it drops out of consideration as an alternative, if and as soon as that assessment is reached. Now, of course, that may need to be reviewed, because it is indeed also an iterative process. You don't reach the final answer until you reach the stage of final approval. But it's exactly the same logic. And the authorities under the SEA Directive say precisely the same thing. They march hand in hand. Again, if I may, I'll use the decision of Mr. Justice Higginbottom, as he then was, in Friends of the Earth, because it summarises the authorities. It's in volume 3, it's tab 56. Given the references in paragraph 1.2 of the note. And the key references are paragraph 88, in particular, subparagraph 47.
Just 56.
Tab 56, paragraph 88. And what Mr. Justice Lindblom was doing in paragraph 88 was he summarising all of the authorities which he cites in paragraph 87 of those convenient judgments. I've already taken the course, and of course already seen paragraph 4, with the concept of the Roman Paul, the concept of reasonable alternative is limited. It's a matter for the decision-making authority, and he cites the authority about public law grounds to challenge or conventional terms. So again, there's no hint there that one should be over-inclusive for consultation purposes. That's emphasised in Roman 5, where the concept of an alternative is considered. We've all seen that before. Then jumping on to Roman 7, there's an explanation of the iterative nature of the process. And it's a lengthy subparagraph, which I invite you to read in due course. But what it says is that the decision maker may need to reassess during the iterative process whether or not something is still a reasonable alternative. Once it has been legitimately discarded, it may not need to be considered further. And that may happen during the iterative process. So once a decision maker has come to a view that something is no longer a reasonable alternative, the proper course is to exclude it, so to avoid wasting the public time. Now, if the public want to argue, for good reason, it ought to come back in, it may need to do that. The facts and circumstances may change and the assessment may change. But under both directives, if the view here on the Secretary of State is that something is not a reasonable alternative or an alternative solution, you get rid of it at that point. And so the suggestion that there is something fundamentally different about the structure and operation of these directives that justifies a different approach to the concept of alternatives is, in our submission, incorrect. So what happened here, of course, is that Gatwick was one of the steps, or one of the alternatives that was considered. That as the process developed, Gatwick was excluded as an alternative, ultimately in the October 2017 consultation, for the purposes of the tax directive alone. And that provisional exclusion was maintained in the final decision. And it was also maintained in the post-adoption statement. But throughout all three of those stages, October 2017 consultation, final decision, post-adoption statement, Gatwick was maintained as a reasonable alternative for the purpose of the ACA rate. And my submission on that is that in the circumstances of this case, the SEA and the Habitat position ought to march together, or they ought to fall by the wayside together. But they didn't, and there's no good reason that has been identified for that. Now, there are a number of factual arguments that were put forward as to why that might be the case. Just to deal with those, if I can invite the court to put away the authorities' volumes for a minute. She referred and relied on the Air Force Commission's conclusions on hub status. And he showed you, and I've given you the references in paragraph 1.3 of the note, evidence that the Air Force Commission had put forward at that early stage reasons why they considered that Gatwick may well be a better option for enhancing and preserving UK hub status. Fine. But despite that, of course, the view of the Air Force Commission was that Gatwick passed its screening process designed to select viable candidates that sufficiently met the strategic hub status requirement. You saw those documents when I opened them. Now, Mr. Humphrey's response this morning to that was he said, well, this is only the shortlist that's being prepared by the Air Force Commission. It doesn't necessarily tell you that much about the final view of the Secretary of State. Well, that's just wrong as a matter of fact. The Secretary of State expressly adopted those findings in the appraisal of sustainability. That reference is not in the note, but it's volume 7, page 581, paragraph 5.5.1.
Sorry, can I just have that again, please?
Do apologise, my lord. It's volume 7, page 581, paragraph 5.5.1.
Thank you. That's in the government's...
That's in the appraisal of sustainability.
Yes.
You've got the final version that was published alongside the AHS. And of course, that's why the government felt it necessary in the final appraisal of sustainability to publish close on 1,000 pages of comparative analysis of Heathrow versus Gatwick in great detail. So it doesn't do the Secretary of State any good to refer to the views of the Airports Commission that Heathrow was a better option on the hub status objective, when, for the purposes of identifying reasonable alternatives, both the Airports Commission and the Secretary of State adopted it, have found that Gatwick does sufficiently well to be an alternative. Considerable reliance is also placed on the wording, would not enhance and would subsequently threaten. And Mr. Huntley this morning also relied on the word only in paragraph 3.71. Now, if that wording were thought to be the coup de grace for Gatwick, which justifies it disappearing, then one has to look at the chronology, because both of those two elements of the wording were present in the October 2017 consultation. Because, of course, that's the point at which hub was elevated to being a reason why Gatwick is not an alternative to Article 6.4 following the September 2017 ministerial submission. That was consulted on, but even at that stage, there was no suggestion that Gatwick was being removed as a reasonable alternative for the purpose of the SEA. We already have my point about the iterative nature of the process is the same under both the SEA directive and under the Habitat directive. If the Secretary of State does in truth come to the view that something is not an alternative, it disappears for the purposes of both directives there and then, of course subject to review. But that's the probable approach. So that wasn't done at any stage during the October 2017 consultation, the final AOS, or the post-adoption statement. The proper analysis in the appellate submission is that there are indeed lawful planning reasons to prefer Heathrow on hub status grounds, but that does not answer the question of whether there are in fact one or more alternative solutions for the purposes of Article 6.4. Because in every case about alternative solutions, there will always, and indeed necessarily, be a lawful preferred option with preferable planning merits in the view of the decision. Those are the facts in relation to hub status. If I can turn to now with the law relating. The risk of oversimplifying, and the appellant says the basic principles of legal analysis are these. First of all, the Habitats Directive is the means by which the EU legislator achieves one of the basic principles of EU law, reflected in the Charter and in Article 191 of the TFEU, namely a high standard of environmental protection. It's secondary legislation under the treaties, under the Charter, which achieves that. It is therefore a scheme for the protection of fundamental rights. And the relevant fundamental rights which are protected are those in Article 6.1 to 6.3, which introduce a scheme of strict protection for European protected sites. Article 6.4 is the derogation from that scheme of strict protection. Proper analysis is that derogations have to be justified, and that the review of a derogation under EU law, I'm speaking generally, I'm not speaking about this particular case, is ordinarily strict. Now, if those basic principles of analysis are right, and I'll come in just a moment and explain why in my submission they are, that's why Mr. Bannon's reliance a few minutes ago on the decision in Evans is completely inapt. Four reasons that were given in the decision in Evans itself. If I could invite the court just briefly to go back to Evans, which is in volume 1, tab 15. this point in evidence is in the judgment before Justice Singh in paragraph 41, where he deals with the submission about fundamental rights. So he says in 41, the argument that the applicant's environmental rights under the EIA directive require proportionality because their fundamental rights is also misconceived. The applicant only has such rights if the development is EIA development. The fundamental right will therefore only be set once the development is found to be an EIA development. Well, indeed, so. But the difference here, under the Habitat Directive, is that there is no question that fundamental rights are engaged. It is common ground between the parties that there is a potential effect of the proposed development of a third runway Heathrow on European sites, and therefore it is necessary to consider whether to derogate from that system of protection under Article 64. And that's why, just on bog standard analysis, the proper approach here is a proportionality analysis for derogation. Now, I advance that submission, I accept, at the level of principle. But looking at the authorities, where do the authorities get it? Well, first of all, there's Smith or Smythe, which is, we don't need to take it up, but it's authorities volume 2 or perhaps 31. They're the submission for rather broader. And they were saying that, in effect, the court's job was to carry out full merits review. Well, that's obviously incorrect. But on this issue of derogation under 6.4, Smith is odiosus. It was decided on a question of 6.3. And the arguments of authorities that the court has seen in this case were not addressed in Smith. Now, what follows, and the submissions that have been made by Mr. Marici and also by Mr. Bannon, are essentially interwoven arguments that what does this mean for the Environmental Impact Assessment Directive? What does this mean for everything else? Well, my submissions are confined to the effect of Article 6.4, which is well established by the case law to be a derogation from the scheme of strict protection. And that's the point which the Advocate General was making in Commission in Portugal. Commission in Portugal, again, we don't need to take it up, but it's volume 2 of the authorities of tab 26. And what the Advocate General said in Commission in Portugal is, look at the wording of 6.4. What 6.4 is it's a derogation, and it involves a structured analysis of the circumstances in which you can remove protection from a European site. What you do, first of all, is you look at the absence of alternatives, then Eropi, and then if those two tests are satisfied, you must introduce compensatory measures to ensure the continued overall coherence of the Natura 2000 network. And it wasn't just in paragraph 42 where the Advocate General referred to an element of the proportionality test. The Advocate General returned to the importance of proportionality at paragraph 45, where she mentions proportionality again. And she deals with that in the context of answering the question of whether, if an alternative exists, the existence of an alternative automatically means you cannot go ahead with the preferred option. And her view, and this is contrary to the view of some of the concerns that were expressed within government that we saw in the ministerial submission, is that it wasn't necessarily the case that the existence of an alternative would always prevent a decision maker from going ahead with the preferred scheme. That was a question again of a proportionality analysis, considering the importance of the European protected sites and the potential consequences. And that's why I mentioned Lumsden in my opening submissions. Not because it of itself tells us something about Article 6.4, but just because it's the leading domestic case summarising how the principle of proportionality should operate in circumstances like this. And it does emphasise that the existence of a proportionary test, a proportionary principle, is an important factor in that analysis. Turning then to Cranehurst and what was said about could I invite the court to look at that one? I know we've been back to it more times than we have to read it. It's volume 1, tab 22. Mr. Marici's analysis of the judgment yesterday was, I submit, just wrong. It relies on missing out the very key paragraphs of the relevant reason. One of the things which he said and the way he hung his hat is that the court did not, in fact, rule on the standard or rigour of review question. In my submission is that that's not the court said they were going to rule with this at paragraph 46. Where they refer to the second line of paragraph 46 concerning the rigour of judicial review of national decisions adopted pursuant to an act of EU law. And then the conclusion is in paragraph 52 that the discretion is limited by the purpose and objectives of the directive, even in cases involving scientific and technical and complex assessments. And that mirrors. Reflects very closely the wording of the Advocate General's opinion in paragraph 56, where the Advocate General sets out her conclusions on the proper test. And that's based on the very detailed analysis you see in the Advocate General's opinion, making some of the points which I've been developing before your lordship, including the proper approach to derogations involving fundamental rights. Then, after paragraph 52, it's paragraph 53 to 55. That deal with the issue of the powers of the national court to issue appropriate orders. And there's a familiar analysis in paragraph 54, principle of effectiveness, which is all well and good. And then paragraph 55, the court notes it didn't really arise on the facts because there was no dispute that under Belgian law, the Belgian administrative court had sufficient powers to issue appropriate orders. The additional authority that was relied on by Mr. Banner is Upjohn, which is volume 4, tab 74, is where we put it.
Are we putting Claydest away now?
We can put Claydest away, my lord. When one reads Upjohn, one has to remember that Upjohn is the equivalent in the medical licensing context of a precautionary principle case. It involves an urgent decision taken by the relevant regulator to ban the marketing of the drug, the benzodiazepine tranquilizer, on the basis that it had started to receive reports of it inducing violent psychosis, leading to people being murdered. So they introduced an emergency precautionary suspension of the marketing of the drug, which unsurprisingly the marketing authorization holder challenged by way of judicial review. And unsurprisingly, the Advocate General in paragraph 50, in the points which, in the passages which just banner for your attention, talks about the importance of freedom of action in the context of urgent and uncertain scientific and judgmental assessment. Well, quite right. But that's different from the relevant context here. There's no doubt that EU law, and indeed the Advocate General in Craneness, cited many authorities of cases in which the EU courts would give considerable deference to questions of such assessment. But the issue in Craneness was whether those principles applied in the same way in cases relating to derogations from a scheme of protection where fundamental rights are engaged. And the Advocate General's conclusion, which is based on an impeccable line of Grand Chamber case law in the recent data cases, was no. You apply the standard and approach of review in a different way in those circumstances. So the appellants have no difficulty with the decision in Upjohn. It is important to look at the circumstances and the facts. Before I turn and deal with moral gap, can I just answer Mr. Marici's point about why there is a challenge from Gatwick Airport? I think it may have been a bit of a jury point, but Gatwick Airport are not the sole authorised voice on the protection of the natural environment, the Habitat Directive. They have their own commercial interests, which they are perfectly entitled to pursue and to express. I'm speaking on the basis only of public domain information, but this year, 2019, marks the expiry of the Section 52 agreement, which Gatwick is subject to, which prevents them from operating their existing backups just finished in July consulting on their master plan to bring that back up runway into regular use, which will enable them to have another 100,000 air transport movements a year, increase
their capacity by a third. Mr. Jeffrey, the fact that Catterick Airport Limited does not object, does not affect the legal issues in the case. There may be good reasons, there may not. That they have reasons of their own which are privy to them. You do not need to invite us to contemplate their reasons.
There may well be all sorts of reasons why Gatwick is perfectly happy with the national policy statements. Indeed, such additional development is expressly provided for in the national policy statements. So I would the only point I need to make is that paragraph 1.39 of the national policy statement encourages and promotes such applications to make further extensive use of existing backup runway resources. And so one might conclude that Gatwick had their own reasons for not trying. It doesn't affect the merits of this case in any way, shape, or form. Mole Gap. The appellants agree that quite often in a habitats case you can't make a decision under 6.4 until the stage of finally granting authorisation for the project. Mr. Marucci cited Commission in the UK, which I've referred to in the note, and that's absolutely correct. We agree with that. We also agree with Mr. Marucci that the precautionary principle applies. We agree with Mr. Marucci that the evidence was in fact uncertain about the orchids. We agree that the single Gatwick report and the limited surveys were not enough to reach a firm view. And we agree we might need to change the management regime and there might be some possibility of orchids in the future. But the consequence of that is that there's no proper basis for excluding Gatwick as an alternative now and making that decision. The only proper legal decision that flows from that is a decision that we can't decide yet, that Gatwick might or might not be an alternative, and we'll decide that at the DCA stage. Or, as an alternative, we're not going to take a decision yet, and what we're going to do is we'll do some more research so we are capable of making a final decision at the ANPS stage. But what we certainly can't do is rule it out at the ANPS stage. That's an area of law. Proper decision is either we're going to go back and do some more work and reach a correct decision, or we are going to expressly accept that it remains open to the DCA stage. And so we say Natural England's ecological conclusions to that effect were impeccable. There's no dispute about them. You do need to do more work. But as a consequence of Natural England's views, saying that in the ANPS you could take a decision excluding Gatwick, that is wrong, in principle. As for the point about the Commission, the concession I think is maintained that the Commission analysis doesn't exist. Mr. Marucci ultimately, in supporting the decision, and that part of the decision doesn't add anything substantial. The remaining point that was taken by Mr. Marucci was the pleading point about the content of our previous claim. And his note included a reference to paragraph 75 of the claimant's grounds. When the court looks at that, look at the final sentence of that paragraph.
What paragraph?
It's volume 2, page 1011, paragraph 75. In the last sentence of that paragraph, the whole rest of the paragraph leads up to it, we make exactly the same points that the court made at paragraph 370 and 371, which the court obviously said that we hadn't made, but in fact we had. If that pleading point is to be sustained, that's the answer. Final point, my lord, is on relief. We're also not going to say anything at this stage, but our written submissions on relief are in volume 2, tab 7, page 745.
Sorry, is that in your skeleton argument as well?
Yes, they're also, we make the same point.
Could you, if you
paragraph can... number?
The paragraph in our skeleton is...
It's just for the sake of having an easy reference to it.
Yes. It's misplaced my volume one. As was said, I think, by Mr. Wolfe last week, the nature of relief and the arguments on it may depend on what the court decides, and so it may be necessary to give the court parties the opportunity to make submissions at that point, perhaps inviting the court.
Yes. So you reserve your position on relief, effectively, which is a fair position, and a fair position for parties, I think, at this stage. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Yes, Mr. Fleming.
Well, I'm conscious I'm the last voice on a long day as the air conditioning system pumps more hot air. Could I add my own contribution? So I have also produced a note of references. Could I hand that up?
Serious point now. Is the air conditioning system working in the wrong direction?
It seems to want to go through moves during the day.
Yes, it is quixotic. We've had this problem in the afternoon, I think, more than the morning. The solution usually is to open both the public door to the court and our door.
Why don't I just be as cool as I can, see if I can bring this out?
Well, that would be characteristic. We open the door. We open the door.
The windows.
Thank you very much. Actually, if a window could be opened as well, I think we will be more comfortable.
Well, as you see from our notice references, we've taken it based on last night on various plans and tests of compliance. Having listened to the submissions this morning, could I perhaps inevitably start with number three?
No.
And go to the test of compliance. Lord, you should have yesterday our summary of issues arising on the approach to review, and I don't want to go back through that. Could I pick up a couple of points that came out during discussion and were addressed by my own friend, were these considered? The first point is to identify what the issue is. And Lord Justice Singh pointed us towards, by way of question, whether or not this was at heart a Hatfield issue. And we say it is. That's looking at either the regulations or the directive. Hatfield, we haven't, of course, provided you with it. Lord Reed, 1968, Peel case of 997, and this is what he said, page 1030 between C and D. Parliament must have conferred the discretion with the intention that it should be used to promote the policy and objects of the Act. And the policy and objects of the Act must be determined by construing the Act as a whole. Construction is always a matter of law for the court. So that is a fundamental point to understand the role of this court, provision court, in reviewing compliance with the directive. And it starts by construing the directive and then trying to identify the legal obligation of those who are bound by its terms. That, we say, is a question for the court. We've summarised the position in paragraph 8 of the note we handed up yesterday, and that's the conflict, whether the Secretary of State enjoys a broad discretion to decide what information an environmental report should include, subject only to low intensity Wednesbury, even lower if you add MOT, even lower still if you add the fact that Parliament involved, or whether the Secretary of State's discretion to determine determine what must be included in an environmental report is constrained by language, by purpose, and by objectives of the directive, and the limits of the discretion, or put another way, the legal obligation on the Secretary of State is a question for the court. So that's the second. Secondly, the second broad point coming from the submission, particularly from my learned friend Mr. Marici, Article 5.2 is worded to make clear that the question of what is reasonably required is an objective one. It does not say, as many domestic statutes can say, either just simply the word may, or that the obligation is for the competent authority. Here the Secretary of State can include what he considers is reasonably required, full stop. You look further in Article 5.2, and then you look much more broadly through the terms of the directive. It says the obligation of the competent authority is to include what is reasonably required, taking into account the list of factors. And the learned friend, Mr. Marici, not surprisingly on behalf of the client he represents, points at the, tries to widen the discretion so that the minister is in control of the information with little control of the court. And then the third general point is the dichotomy. Is it all a question for the court, or is it all a question for the Secretary of State? The all for the question of the court was the mistaken submission made in Smith Smile, that it becomes a merits review. No, obviously not. All for the discretion of the Secretary of State, we say, goes too far. And the court has to determine what the limits of the discretion are, and you've seen and heard of the submissions on Cranest, I won't repeat.
Do you adopt Mr. Jeffy's submissions on the Cranest?
Yes. Yeah. Could I just mention a couple of broader points? Up, John, we adopt what my friend, Mr. Jeffy's just said. It doesn't either seem to affect the propositions from Cranest. Discretion is in environmental directives is constrained by the terms of the directive and general principles of a European community law. And it's for the court to construe and verify compliance. So we see no conflict between the two cases. Could I, before getting into the cases, and I'll do this at speed because it's either there in our notes or the lines are, I thought, absolutely clear by now. It was said, I think, repeatedly by both my learned friend Mr. Marici and Mr. Banner, that Lord Hoffman's reference to Blewett was a directive reference rather than an EIA follow-on from Blewett. As if by referring to the IPCC, there was some wider endorsement. We have to accept that in the world of EIA, because of Edwards, because of the one paragraph in Lord Hoffman's speech in that case, that Blewett has been endorsed at the highest level. Well, it may not be apparent from the report, but I was in the case until it went to the House of Lords, reasonably familiar with its terms, and one day I can describe the extraordinary scenes in the Court of Appeal, but perhaps not today. What is, however, clear, and I'm surprised that Mr. Marici is making this point, is if you look at Edwards, and I'll take this again just by showing you two pages. Yeah. It's tab 40 of volume 3. And you can pick it up at paragraph 46. Lord Hoffman's speech begins on page 62 of your Lincoln report. And cutting it short, if you turn to page 72, paragraph 46, before that there's a reference to common law duty of fairness. If you go further, there's reference to the Justice found that as this information coincided with that inquired by the EIA director, the public had been given the opportunity to make representations about it. The requirements of the director had been satisfied. The same, in my opinion, is true of the application in this case. And there you get the reference to paragraph 41 in Blewett, and then further the reference to this about the Barclay case. So what you have at the highest authority is an endorsement of the whole of paragraph 41 of Blewett, including the last sentence, which is now, thankfully, at least diluted into or turned into a lower, less demanding test for those who challenge such statements. Because until we got to the divisional court in this case, the approach on Blewett is that if you could take our example, if you could show that you have considered the area, then that would be the end of the challenge, because you would have ticked that box, so it couldn't be said that it is not an environmental statement. So could I leave that to one side? Also, I have to respectfully remind this court, so far as it needs reminding, that where Lord Hoffman has, even where Lord Hoffman has spoken, care must be taken in applying such statements in another statutory context and other factual circumstances. And that's Lord Conway in Walton, in your cases without taking you to it, volume 1, tab 13 of paragraph 127. Said we don't repeat our submissions on the direct test. We say, and you can see this from our references in the note on the second page, you can find, we say, the answer in the Forest Heath case and also in Heard. There was a suggestion that in the Heard case there's no specific endorsement of paragraph 12 of decision in, say, historic Newmarket. That's right, but when you go through the Heard, could you look at paragraph, I think it's paragraph 13, where there's reference back to paragraph 40 of the decision in Forest Heath. For the other cases, the now familiar cases that we referred to, I'm only going to deal in any detail you want. You have the references on Shadwell, Gladden, and Glerthelton, and on FOE. I just wanted to look at no ad astra and cogent, because there seems to be some misunderstanding of what was going on in those two cases. The Lordships have the benefit of the presence on the panel of Lord Justice Singh, who can deal with what he intended in cogent. But it seems clear to us when reading that judgment that what that case was about was the fact that the assessment process is not merely the report, and therefore you have a continuing opportunity to correct errors. So when one gets to no ad astra, again, we do have the references. It may be helpful, just on this last point on the law, to have a quick look at cogent and no ad astra. There are two reports of no ad astra, and it's helpful to look at both. Right. So I will take you through. Cogent is volume 3, tab 48. Analysis along the same lines as we suggest is the correct approach. So if you take up cogent and go to paragraph 89, see, with reference to Herb in 89, taken in isolation, I would be inclined to accept the submissions that are made above. The argument being the documents
set out adequately the reasons for preferring the alternatives is indeed prudent. However, so accepting an adequacy test just for the purpose of what follows, however, the matter does not rest there, in my view. This is because the claimant's submission depends on its grounds 3 and 4 relating to the addendum. If, as the defendant and Bellway submit, the addendum cured any defects in the earlier stage, and if, as a matter of law, it was capable of doing so, there would be no merit in ground 2. So having found potentially there is an error, the error can be corrected, and that's how the process continues. And if you get through to page 33 of the PMCR report, paragraph 112, this is now a repetition of what I was saying earlier, that the SEA is not a single document, it's a process. And then picking up Seaport and other cases, over the page to Heard and Forest Heath, you get to the extract from paragraph 40 of Mr. Justice Collins' judgment in Forest Heath at 123. Could your lordships pick up the last sentence, which is endorsed or followed by Mr. Justice Boosley and Heard? The previous reports did not properly give the necessary explanations and reasons, and in any event were not sufficiently summarised. These are views of the court on the quality of the environmental report they were considering, entirely consistent with our submission. And then you go into 124, ending with the last few words, can the defects be cured by a later document? And the answer is yes, and at 126 is where you get the reference to EIA report, and what is said is that the submission by the defendant and Bellwood, an analogy can be drawn, and the analogy is then set out in paragraph 41 from Mr. Justice Sullivan and Lewis, and in particular, it's the middle of that paragraph. They recognise that an environmental statement may be deficient and make provision through the publicity and consultation processes for any deficiencies to be identified, so that the resulting environmental information provides the local planning authority with as full a picture as possible. And then you have the last two words. The main point is the analogy is about curing defects. So when you get to know Adastral, which you'll find in the same bundle at paragraphs at tabs 52 and 53, I'll take this at speed, but could I invite you to read the judgment of the late Mrs. Justice Patterson, and you will see that what she was finding, if you go through her reasoning, in paragraph 105 is where the reference back to Cogent occurs, and 105 is an important introduction to what follows, ending with whether or not the scheme of the directive and the regulations was in fact breached or depended on the facts of each case. She then finds that there were significant errors, picking up a reference to Cogent 123, the opposite page of 129. There were errors, or the argument was that there were errors, but they were capable of being corrected, and you see that at 129. I don't need to have no time to go through that in any greater detail. No Adastral in the Court of Appeal shows that what was being accepted was the analysis that there is an opportunity to correct errors. You see that in the issues in the appeal on page 565. And paragraph 52 shows Lord Justice Singh was drawing an analogy rather than endorsing in the SEA context what was being said in the EIA context, because there were no submissions before him along the lines that we are now making. And then 53, there's reference to Mr. Buxton.
did not disagree with the analysis in Cogent. That was a realistic stance. In my judgment, the conclusion reached by Mr. Justice Singh on the issue of principle was correct for the reasons he gave. And then at the end of that paragraph, 54, you will see that 54 is dealing with defects that can be corrected. And it ends with two or so words. In other words, if one reads through Noah Dastrell with the sense of what was decided in Cogent, there's no support for a proposition that at Court of Appeal level there's been an endorsement in the SEA context of the Blivett approach. Well, I don't have time to refer to the other cases, but we invite you to not accept the EIA transference because of the various reasons we've given. Could I turn at increasing speed to areas? A couple of points. Two points were made really that need to be dealt with and hit on the head straight away. One, it was suggested that our pleadings have changed. Our case has been a constant. And you can see I'll give you the references to the division court. Well, volume 2, in the pleading, page 1024 to 1026, paragraphs 122 and 130, and then the skeleton, 82 to 84, in the same document. So I won't take you to this. But the point is a very simple point. It's either wrong or it's right. We know that there were only indicative guidelines. We know that the likely, almost inevitable change is that there would be different guidelines because there's a flight path review and the development of Heathrow is so colossal in terms of the impact on the London area because of Luton, Stansted, City and Gatwick. That there will be a need to change flight paths so that all the planes would not bump into each other. Obvious point. We say in those circumstances, you don't make better indicative flight paths unless you cover all the potential area. What you do is you go for what is said to be the right approach in Annex 1C. You identify the environmental characteristics, important words, of the areas in which we say it is likely that there will be significant effects. Now, you have to keep in mind at all times that we're talking about flight movements. What you end up, however one looks at this, is you are either going to say, this court is either going to say, as did the divisional court, that you can disregard the areas where it is likely, inevitable, there will be significant effects by relying on an indicative flight path. There are examples in the bundle, and if you go back to the Airports Commission, you can see it's a long, elongated sausage around Heathrow with spurs. Nothing like the consultation carried out by Hal in January this year. So either that's acceptable, that is a discharge of the duty, the obligation in Annex 1C, or it's not. And if it's not, it's not for us, it's not for the boroughs to go to the expense of producing their own plans. All we're pointing out is a legal error. At that point, move back to the Secretary of State, quash the decision. The Secretary of State liaises with the CAA and produces an acceptable version of what we have sought to illustrate from Howe's consultation, either back in January 18 or in January 19. So back to the third witness statement of Colin Stanley. Mr. Humphreys, before he flew away, says that the plans were irrelevant. Well, that's a graceful note upon which he departs. They're not irrelevant at all. They are incomplete. So if you could turn to the witness statement of Mr. Stanley, what you have is two pages on the yellowy pages are the easterly operations on page 4, the westerly operations on page 3. Arrivals, looking at page 4 to your left, departures to your right, and the opposite on the page 3. And of course it's going all the way to 7,000 feet because it's taken from Hal's consultation document, which is said to be both DCO and ACP. And all of this distraction, saying this was only about the ACP, it simply that, it's a distraction. And if you can see that the intention was to consult with Con 1 in relation to the DCO. Yes, draw a different line, take a different circle, take a contour of 54 decibels, take a contour of 51. But don't do what you've done. Don't just use an indicative set of plans that you know are not going to be the right plans. And it's no good then saying we've had a consultation and Sir Jeremy Sullivan thought that it was a good thing. Because when you scatter your leaflets around and you show people how to access the indicative flight paths, what they're going to find is they're not covered. And that gives them comfort and allows them not to protest. Now, this is particularly important for the parts that are completely omitted in the replies. Environmental characteristics of the areas includes sensitive receivers, the hospitals, the schools, the places of worship. So it means the hospital management is not able to be alerted that there might be flights over it. The care home, the open spaces, the local authorities that are not being told that there will be flights over their territory. Simple point, I hope simple to explain. There's some criticism of Mr. Morici of paragraphs 9 and 10 of the witness statement. If you look at, do this, I hope, in a minute, and then the plans will have to be half. If you look at what has been circulated in January, so go to volume 9. I know that Mr. Humphreys and his clients want to downplay what they were doing in the context. So it's had 9, page 2093. What you see in this document information in these plans which are relevant to those who live in underneath. And if you look at the noise information, you see that heading?
Yes.
We have also provided an indication of the number of flights that may exceed 65 decibels, not 54, 65, equivalent to noise levels in a busy office. This measure, known as N65, is recommended in both the Secretary of State's air navigation guidance and the CAA's airspace design guidance. This in our witness statement, we point out a couple of caveats. But just turn over the next page. What you have is a number of bands. Clearly, the closer you get to the northern runway of Heathrow, the starker the details are. What you see is height band going up to 7,000 feet. Let's pause at 3,000 to 4,000 feet. As you go through those bands, and you'll see where 4,000 feet takes you to on this example, you are going to expect, it says here, 29 flights an hour, and the number of flights above 65 decibels will be 0 to 5, at 2,000 to 3,000, 0 to 25. And even at 4,000 to 5,000, we're getting flights that are above 65 decibels. So what this gives the person who lives under the flight path, perhaps reduced so it only goes to 4,000 feet, is at least some warning that there will be flights that will be harmful. So you end up with this analysis on this point. There are two ways of dealing with this. One is the Secretary of State, look at the set of indicative flight paths, and that will do, even if you know Caroline Lowe of paragraph 5.5, CB 6.226, that these are only where flights could be. For our approach, select a spatial area around the airport within which the final actual flight paths will necessarily be set.
So, Mr. Blaine, can you just help us with where we get the decibel feed in and the overlays?
In their document?
Yes, 2096, 2097. How do we...
You don't. What you get is, taking the one I was showing you, my lord, as the first of many examples. So where you... Can you take that?
2097, we're looking at.
If you look at 2098, arrivals to the northern or middle runway, westerly operation, what you get at 3,000 to 4,000 feet is there will be up to 47 flights an hour. And if you go to the next column, the number of flights above 65 decibels, from that list, it did say 10. If you go online, it says 32. So the answer is a number of flights per hour will be above 65 decibels. So it's only done by reference to bandwidth. Did your lordship see the column?
Yes.
And then that applies as you turn each page.
Yes, thank you.
For all sorts of reasons, I'm very hesitant to rise on this, but... These figures, the 65 decibel, is the N65 measure. That's to say, the noise experienced from a single flight passing. The other figures that have been discussed in the hearing have all been LAEQ measures. It's a different measure of noise, so 51 and 54. So one cannot read 65 over a completely different measure.
No, I don't think a comparison is being made for purposes of dB levels. Point that is being made is one as to approach.
Yes,
I think.
All this. Sorry.
So the court is not under a misapprehension, Mr. Turney.
All this tells you is taking these bands of height, those who are underneath, take the example of the hospital or the children's playground, will have a busy office flying overhead 20 times an hour or whatever. That's not the same as Lowell, Sowell, and the others. When you go back to look at the references in the AOS to Lowell and Sowell, please take care of what is said by Mr. Humphreys, because what is clear is that over Lowell, between Lowell and Sowell, is still significant. When you get to Sowell, it's harmful, and one has to be careful. That's why when you look at the indicative flight path, it has 54, only 57. We say it should be 51, and you've heard the arguments. Could I end this, and without taking you to plans, say to show you the references, is that what we say in terms of analysis is consistent with the precautionary principle. When faced with uncertainty as to how to identify areas likely to be significantly affected, don't take the Secretary of State's approach. Take the approach that recognises that there is uncertainty, and then make the approach we've suggested. It's also entirely consistent with the case that I note that neither of my friends referred to, which is the opinion by Advocate General Cocotte that I mentioned earlier in paragraphs 41 to 42, tab AB3, tab 57. That's speed going through the document, and I'm conscious that we've lost quite a bit of time.
Where are you now in your note?
I'm just going through references at speed. Would it help, Lord, if I turn, I've got two pages of note on this area, and just type it up and hand it to you, Lordship?
Well, what would you prefer?
I'm happy to stop there and hand this up. It's only two pages, and it will take me, I expect, a bit longer, and I haven't said anything about that. I'd prefer to...
Well, what would you prefer to do?
Well, I prefer to send you a note in the next hour, which is really the speaking note, as my other friends.
You're content with that approach?
I'm content. Unless I've covered the principles, covered the main points, that's all right. What I wanted to say on plans, and I can do the same, is the evidence led by my learned friends have missed the point again completely. We are saying that, yes, this is a national airports, a national policy statement, but this is site-specific. It will have inevitably an enormous impact on Hillingdon, taking one example, and London with its LES and its carbon intentions. Those plans are obviously relevant. Merely to group them together as a lot of plans cumulatively and say we have dealt with the topic covered in those plans is simply to misunderstand Appendix 1.1a. It's dealing with, important word, the relationship between the plan, the expansion of Heathrow, and the plans to which it relates, which here, without doubt, is Hillingdon. One little piece of evidence, and we'll put this in one of the references, Natural England, to whom we must give great regard, says you should be looking at local plans. You should be interacting with local plans. It doesn't mean all the plans all over England and Wales. It means in particular Hillingdon and in particular London and Egypt. And those are, we say, public law, unforgivable errors. Well, could I turn that into the briefest of notes with the references, particularly to Ursula Stevenson's reference, witness statements, which you can see in our note of references in about four or five paragraphs. It won't be much of
it. Just allow me a moment. Yes, we're all happy with that approach, if you are content with it.
Yes, unless there were any questions that I hope I've picked out the highlight.
We would have asked any questions as we went along, but I'll just make sure that my colleagues have none.
Do Mr. Jaffe and I the greatest favour and excuse us from listening to the next case when it comes up this morning?
Granted. Thank you very much, Mr. Fleming. Thank you, Mr. Jaffe. Thank you all very much. We're going to stop now and resume at 10:00 in the morning, and at which point we turn to the next phase of the hearing. Thank you very much.